So I think we can start the session now. So good evening, one and all present here. Myself, Swapna, faculty in Jyoti Engineering College. This webinar in Machine Learning Towards Deep Learning is jointly organized by IE and TESA, Computer Science Students Association of Jyoti Engineering College. Our speaker for today is Dr. J. Anita, who is faculty in Department of CSE, Karani Institute of Technology and Sciences. On behalf of Jyoti Engineering College and Department of CSE, I do welcome Dr. J. Anita. And I also welcome one and all present in this webinar on behalf of Jyoti Engineering College and CSE Department. I request Ms. Anjali and Pratap, student coordinator, to give a brief introduction about Dr. J. Anita. Anjali.
Thank you, Swapna ma'am, for the introduction, and good evening to all. I am Anjali and Pratap, here to give a brief introduction about our guest speaker. Dr. J. Anita completed her Bachelor of Engineering in Information Technology with first class distinction and was a university rank holder in 2004 from Manonmanya and Sundarna University, India. She completed her Master's in Engineering in Computer Science with first class distinction in 2006 from Manonmanya and Sundarna University. She started her teaching career in Nurul Islam College of Engineering from March 2006. Currently, she is working as an assistant professor in Karani University since January 2007. She completed her doctoral degree in Computer Science and Engineering from Karani University in the area Mammogram Medical Image Segmentation and Classification. Her research interests include medical image processing, computer vision, machine learning, and deep learning. She has published her research articles in Elsevier, Springer, and InterScience with good impact factors and is a reviewer too. She is also a co-principal investigator of a Department of Science and Technology sponsored and funded project for a worth of rupees 40 lakhs. She is an active member in all departmental activities. She is also a lifetime member of the Computer Society of India. I am not going to take up more time, but before we start the session, a gentle reminder to all participants to post your queries in the chat box. All queries will be answered to after the session. Now over to you, Anita ma'am.
Thank you for the introduction. Are you audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now I share my screen.
Yeah, ma'am, please.
Okay, so good evening to one and all. So I would like to thank the management and the HOD of Computer Science of Jyoti Engineering College for giving me this opportunity. And also I thank the organizing committee members of this event. Today's session, I'm going to talk about machine learning towards deep learning. So this is the agenda of my presentation. So first I will start with artificial intelligence and then move to machine learning, and we'll discuss the various types of machine learning algorithms, and then we'll see a case study. Then followed by deep learning and some basic models in the deep learning, and followed by a case study. So this is the outline of our presentation today's session. And first, so why we need AI today? Okay, so due to there is a demand of AI, so demand, the AI is demanded due to more computational power, more data, better algorithms, and broad investments. So what is more computational power? So computational power is, nowadays we have more computational power, and it is achieved through advanced technologies and deep learning models which were launched. So one of the more advanced technology which is made possible is using GPU. So anyone, can you tell what is GPU in the chat box? So you know about GPU, what is the use of GPU? So you can give a message in your chat box. So anyone know what is an expansion of GPU? Okay, so I just go through it. So GPU is nothing but graphical processing unit. So as compared with CPU, so GPU will run more concurrently and it will more efficient than CPU, okay? And due to this available more computational power, we can use AI in our daily life. and more data. So we are in the internet world now. We are collecting several data through social media, then IoT, etc. So we need to provide some solution in order to access these data and analyze this data and to get some insight information from it. So we are training the AI machines with large data set and big data, so which make it possible to use these data in an efficient manner. And then better algorithms. We have efficient algorithms in terms of neural networks, and these better algorithms leads to better performance, and that will leads to better accuracy. So you can make it, this is also one of the demand of AI. And broad investment, so universities, government agencies, and tech giant companies, everyone is investing in AI technology. So the companies like Amazon, Google, they are also providing high investment in the AI technology, because we all believe that AI is the future. So now we will move to some application areas of AI. So first of all, one of the application of AI is in the health sector. So which is mainly used for medical diagnosis. So I think you all heard about IBM Watson expert system, and also Google also introduced something called this AI eye doctor. So which is used to diagnose the retinal diagnosis, that is diabetic retinopathy. And also we have AI assisted robots that also used in the medical field. So when you come to the computer vision field, so in manufacturing industries and in AI tech, that is in virtual reality technologies and smart parking systems. So everywhere we are using AI technology. So in the case of agriculture, we are using AI to monitor the crop growth. And Tesla also introduced some self-driving car. And we heard about some personal assistant like Alexa, Siri. So that also provide human touch through these AI technology. So you all know about the social media, Twitter, Facebook and all. So whenever you post some picture of you, so immediately the AI technology behind the social media analyze the features available in your picture, and it will try to tag the friends for you. And you know about search engine. So search engine will give a recommendation based on guess. So Google is one of the best search engine, so which will collect the information based on your previous history, age, location, and your profile information. So that based on that, it will provide the recommendation to you. And another one application area of AI is e-commerce. So everyone have experienced the e-commerce application. So everyone used Amazon. So it will recommend the product, same as you can use for YouTube, Netflix, and all. And AIs are not restricted only these areas. So in finance sector also we are using AI technology, because manually verifying the documents in finance sector is very a tedious process. But using AI technology made it possible. And natural language processing are used in chatbot and speech translation. So the applications of AI is not only restricted here, still it having various variety of areas that we can use AI. So can anyone guess what it is? Anyone have an idea? So can we have an interactive session? So you can type something in your chat box. So what do you know about this, what it represents? So anyone have an idea what it represents? Okay, so this is nothing but Microsoft introduced a hologram. So this, you know, I think you all seen in the YouTube. So during the 2019 Microsoft conference called Microsoft Inspire 2019, so Microsoft introduced a magic of AI neural TTS, text to speech and hologram. So using this AI based technology, they have developed a hologram. The hologram reflect like a speaker. The speaker is speaking in an English language. So this hologram try to translate that English language into Japanese. So how it is done? So the language, the voice, whatever, the pitch, everything talked by the speaker is as such reflected in the hologram. So how it is done? So initially, whatever the speaker is speaking in English, that English voice will be now first translated into text. And that English text is now translated into Japanese text. Then by using your neural network algorithms, and this will be again translated to text to speech in Japanese language. So this is one of the advancements using AI. And now, so everyone have a confusion with the terms AI, ML, and DL. So to clear the confusion, this slide provides a relationship between AI, ML, and DL. So you can visualize the relation between these three terms in terms of Russian nesting doll. Have you seen this doll? So it is a nesting doll. So like that, AI also like a nesting thing. So AI is a whole set, and ML is the subset of AI, and deep learning is the subset of machine learning. So you all know artificial intelligence is an engineering which will make the machine intelligent through programs. And machine learning has the ability to learn the machine without being explicitly programmed. And deep learning is generally based on deep neural network. And data is the main component in deep learning and machine learning. So we have a different area called as big data, data science, and that also a vast research area. Okay. So how you can make a machine to be intelligent? So you can make a machine to be intelligent by imposing the intelligence to the machine in terms of mathematical model. So in order to do that, we are doing the algorithms. So by writing the algorithms, we are trying to impose intelligence through the mathematical model to the machine. So the machine can now become artificially intelligent. And the word AI is evolved in different forms during different time periods. When you go in 1950 to 1980, initially we have artificial intelligence, and later in 1980, it has become machine learning, and nowadays we are talking about deep learning. So initially in 1950, Alan Turing, he developed an artificial machine called as Turing test, which is used to check the ability of the machine to check whether it is having a capable of thinking like a human. Okay, so later in 1956 only, John McCarthy coined the name called as artificial intelligence. And in 1959, Arthur Samuel has coined the name called as machine learning. So nowadays we are using deep learning. So deep learning, the technology behind deep learning is the brain network and the neural network. And what is next? What we are expecting next? So we are expecting some machines that will provide beyond human level performance. And these are the most advancements that can be achieved through these eras. The first one is the IBM Deep Blue Chess Program, which is developed by IBM. So this is a chess playing computer which can able to play with the human, and it also defeated the chess champion Kasparov. And mainly artificial intelligence are used to developing games. And another one application of machine learning is IBM Watson. And it is again a question answering system, which is also again developed by IBM. So whenever you give some question through your natural language, it can able to answer you. Google search engine, Amazon recommendation, email spam filter, that also using the concept of machine learning. And one of the advancements in deep learning is AlphaGo. This is again a computer system which will play a board game. It is developed by DeepMind Technology, and this computer system also defeated the human player Go player, that is the champion of Go player. And natural speech recognitions are working with deep learning, and the self-driving car systems also working with deep learning. And now, what is an artificial intelligence? So artificial intelligence is nothing but we are trying to incorporate human intelligence to the machine so that the machine can mimic like a human. So you want to make the machine to behave like a human. So we are imposing the intelligence to the machines. So how we are imposing the intelligence? So we are giving the data to the machine to make the machine to learn through its experience. So the behind technology of artificial intelligence is knowledge-based system and inference engine. So here all the terms involved in artificial intelligence is symbolic less. So it will write rules, facts, logics, predicates, then expert system, knowledge graphs. So everything is represented in terms of symbolic logic. And these are the various types of artificial intelligence. Sorry, are you able to follow? Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. No problem.
Okay. So the first type of artificial intelligence is artificial narrow intelligence, which is again a weak AI. The example for artificial narrow intelligence is the Alexa. So it can able to do only specific task. There is no genuine intelligence and no self-awareness. And the next type of artificial intelligence is artificial general intelligence, and it is a strong AI which has the ability to perform any intelligent task that a human being can. So the examples are your Google search engine, Sophia the robot, self-driving car and all. Okay, but still it doesn't have any reasoning and thinking capability. And this artificial general intelligence having very strong processing units also. The third level of artificial intelligence is the artificial super intelligence, and which has the capability of computers which surpasses the capacity of human intelligence. Okay, so we think that we need some machine that overtake human, but still it is imaginary only in Terminator movies and fiction books. And now we are moving to machine learning. So machine learning, or the computer system which has the ability to learn automatically and improve from experience without being explicitly programmed. So how the machine can able to learn? We enable the machine to learn by providing some data. So by using these data, the machine can able to make some accurate prediction. As we already seen that in AI, all are represented in symbolic approach, but now machine learning is moved to methods and models. So machine learning models are mainly work based on machine learning algorithms, and these algorithms learn and improve over time when it is exposed with new data. So in case of machine learning, we want to make the machine to think, or you want to make the machine to make some decision. So how we are going to do this? So you will feed the data to your machine. So the machine will learn how to interpret, process, analyze by using the various machine learning algorithms. So by using that, it can able to solve the real world problems. And according to the Tom Mitchell, the definition of machine learning is represented as a computer program is said to learn from experience E with respect to some class of task T and the performance measure of P. So whenever a machine do some task, the machine's performance is evaluated, that is P. So if the performance is good, the machine will follow the same task. So if the performance go down, the machine will learn from experience and try to remodify its task in order to improve its performance. So the machine learning is composed of three things, that is the performance at task in T, which is measured by P, that will improve with the experience E. And now we'll see some terminologies available in the machine learning. So before getting inside the terminologies, I have given one problem statement here. You need to determine the type of fruit. Okay, so as a human, if I give a fruit to your hand, so by seeing the fruit, by checking the color, by seeing its size, seeing its texture, you can easily identify what is the type of fruit. But as a machine, the machine cannot able to identify it. So you have to prepare some data set, and that data set has to be given to the machine. The machine has to learn from the data set. Okay, so these data set contain some information, that is the mass of the fruit, width of the fruit, height of the fruit, and the color score of the fruit. Because the machine can understand only numerical values, so your data set contain all as numerical values. So based on these features, the machine can able to predict whether that fruit is the apple, lemon, or orange. That also again, we cannot give us a string value, so you have to give us a fruit label. So if the fruit is apple, so it will be recognized as 1. If it is a lemon, it will be recognized as 2. If it is an orange, it will be recognized as 3. So like that, the machine is allowed to learn through the machine learning algorithm along with the data set. And later some point, you give a new input. You give only the mass, width, height, and color score. So now the machine can able to predict what is the type of the fruit, whether it is apple, lemon, or orange. So now we are telling about, these are called as features. So what is meant by features? So features are nothing but the important informations which are taken from the particular input. So for example, if you are using with the email messages, means the feature is the list of words. So whoever doing project in text analysis, you know that the list of words, whatever you consider. So you do with sentiment analysis, Twitter analysis. So you will take the list of words as a feature. And in terms of image processing project, we all consider it as a picture. So if you take a picture, you will take an intensity, then color, then you will talk about edges, lines, whichever are available in the picture. But if you take any objects, the object's property will give the feature of that object, that is the color, shape, the width, height, and depth. Okay. So I think now we all clear about what is the feature and how the machine will work. So first of all, the term used in the machine learning is algorithm. So you already know that algorithm is nothing but set of rules which is used to learn information from the given data, and we try to draw some useful insights from it. The basic logic behind any machine learning model is the machine learning algorithm. So model is nothing but a main component in the machine learning which is trained by the machine learning algorithm. And now we are having something called as predictor variable, response variable. So predictor variable is nothing but the features whichever you use to predict the data, okay, predict the output. So as given in the case study, can you able to tell what are the data are predictor variables? So anyone post it in the chat box, what are the things are called as predictor variables? Are you able to type? So here for the given data set, what are the things are called as predictor variables? Okay, I think no one is typing in the chat box. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. No one is giving a response. That's why. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So I want to make some.
Ma'am.
So it will be interactive. So if you give the answer, yes.
Yeah, they are typing, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, thank you. So anyone, you can give what are these from the given data, case study, whatever we have taken. What are the things that are called as predictor variables? Okay, so here the mass, width, height, and the color space, everything will be called as a predictor variable. So by means of these variable only, you try to predict whether the fruit is apple, orange, or lemon. So these variables are called as predictor variable. And next is called as response variable or output variable. And here the fruit label will be called as a response variable because it needs to be predicted by using the predictor variables. That is mass, width, height, and color score. So the fruit label will be now called as a response variable, and remaining all will be called as a predictor variable. And next we move on to the next terminology, that is training data, which is nothing but a subset of data set which is used to construct your machine learning model. So by using these training data only, your machine learning model try to learn and find some similar patterns available in your data set. And the next phase is the testing data. So the machine learning model will be evaluated using these testing data. So this only used to tell how accurately your machine can able to predict the outcomes. So now the next thing is machine learning process. Machine learning process involves building of a predictive model which is used to find the solution for a given problem statement. And these are the steps involved in the machine learning process. First, you have to define the objective. Next, data gathering, preparing the data, data exploration, building a model, model evaluation, and finally prediction. So first, defining an objective. Okay. So whenever some input data is given to you, you have to study the features from the input data, and you have to predict what is the possibility outcome from this data. Then only you can able to identify what is the objective of your problem. So you have some data set. You have to know what you want to do with this data. What are the things available in this data? Then only you can able to form your problem statement. That is defining the objective. So once your data is there, you can able to identify what are the predictor variables and what is your output variable. And then you have to decide what kind of problem you want to solve, whether it is a regression, classification, or clustering. So later slide, you will see what is regression, classification, and clustering. And the next step in the process is the data gathering. So data gathering is very, very tedious process, and it is also a time consuming step in the machine learning process. I think whoever doing research work in medical image processing, surely you will accept that mean the data gathering is a very, very time consuming process. Okay, so you have to decide which data to gather, where to collect these data and all. So either the data can be collected manually or online. So whenever you try to collect manual data, it takes lot of time. But nowadays we have lot of resources, repositories are available in online, so you can directly collect these data either by downloading or through web scraping. The next step is the data preparation or data cleaning. So generally whatever data you collected, it will not be in the correct format. So it has to need some data preparation and data cleaning. So the data may contain some inconsistency, either it have a missing value, redundant value, corrupted values or unnecessary data. Because if you are using the data as such, it may lead to wrong prediction. So sometimes you need to do something called as we need to analyze the data, whether the data having a different ranges. Okay, so for example, consider you have a data with age and the salary. So generally you know that ages have a ranging of 0 to 100, but salary have a range of 0 to 1 lakh and above that also. So if you are using these data as such in your machine learning model, so your machine learning model will be influenced by the that is the income data, that is it having large variation because 0 to high amount of salary. So that time we need to do something in a data preparation. Whether anyone know what to do for that? The ages from 0 to 100, your salary is from 0 to 1.
Use a log scale.
Log scale. No, actually you have to do something called as normalization. So we have to normalize the data and you have to define the same range for your age and income. So it is easy for you to use these data without affecting the influences. Okay, so data cleaning also takes 80% of time in your whole machine learning process. And step 4, we are going to do with the exploratory data analysis. So you have to understand the patterns and trends available in your data in order to model the solution. So in Python itself, there is a separate section which having exploratory data analysis. Whatever you can play with data, you can do with the exploratory data analysis. Okay. So at this stage, you can derive some useful insights and also you can able to find out the correlation between the variables. So I'll tell one example, what is the correlation between the variables. Okay. So you want to calculate the body mass index. So you all know that the formula for body mass index is based on height and the weight of a person. So here height and weight are highly correlated. So in order to identify the body mass index, okay. So now we have three types of correlation. One is positive correlation, negative correlation, and no correlation. So positive correlation means when the x-axis increase, the y-axis also increase. It is called as positive correlation. Negative correlation means the x-axis increase, the y-axis decrease. It is called as negative correlation. So the last one is no correlation. So x-axis increase, y-axis, there is no change. And in step 5, we have to do model building. So once the insights and patterns are derived from your exploratory data analysis, next step, you have to build a predictive model. In this step, you have to divide your data set into two parts. One is called as training data set and another one is called as testing data set. So training set data set is used to build your model. So basically the training data set is always more than the testing data set. Here I have given some split ups of training and testing data set. So the training can be 66.7, testing can be 33.3. The training can be 75, testing is 25, training can be 90 or 10. These are the common used splitting of data set. Okay, so the training data set should be always greater than the testing data set. So now the model is built by using these machine learning algorithms with the help of these training data. So which machine learning algorithm you are going to use for your problem, that depends upon again your problem domain. And the sixth step is model evaluation. And in this stage, you are using the testing data to check the efficiency of the model. In step 5, your model is now built. Now you want to check the efficiency of the model. So that you do with the model evaluation using the testing data. You have to test how accurately your system can predict the outcomes. So generally the performance is evaluated in terms of accuracy. So if you want to improve the accuracy, you have to tune some parameters in your model, which is available in step 5. So you have to rebuild the model and again you have to retrain it, and then you have to evaluate until you get a satisfied performance. And finally, the last step is prediction. Once the model is evaluated and improved, the final step is the prediction step. The final output you can get either categorical or continuous variable, depends upon again your problem domain. And now we'll move to types of machine learning algorithm. The machine learning algorithms are basically categorized into three categories: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So supervised learning. So supervised learning you consider like a teacher-student thing. Okay. So the teacher is teaching the concept in the classroom, and later during the exam, the students are asked to answer the questions based on the concepts taught in the class. So like that, the supervised learning algorithm also learned with an external guidance. So here all the data are labeled explicitly. And the next type is unsupervised learning algorithm. Okay, I'll tell one example. So you are going to your friend's home. Everyone is watching cricket in TV. So you don't know anything about cricket playing. So after some time, by seeing what they are doing, you can able to understand something about the cricket. Okay. So after some time, you can able to understand, okay, there are two groups of people are playing. By knowing the color of their t-shirts, you can able to understand, okay, there are two teams are playing. And then you will understand, okay, two persons having bats. So there is batsman. Then you have a bowler and then fielder. So like that, you itself try to understand. Then whenever the ball go out of boundary, everyone is cheering up. So you will know, okay, that is a win. So if the ball is catched by some person, so everyone become very sad. So you know that, okay, loss of wicket. So like that, the algorithm also learned by itself using the data set. So here the data are not labeled. Okay, the system itself learned by itself using these data set. The last one is reinforcement algorithm. So again, you are a new employee to a company. So you have joined in the company. One task is given to you. Okay. So if you did the task good, you will get an appreciation. So if you did some mistake in the task, you will get a penalty. So by making mistakes and correcting them, you itself learn yourself, and that is called as reinforcement learning. So like that, the machine also learned by itself. After making many mistakes, it will correcting them. Now I will see, I will show how the supervised learning algorithm is working. Okay. So now I have given some set of images, which is all type of fruits, that is apple, which is of different colors, textures, and with the different orientation. So I have labeled all the inputs with apple. So now my machine is able to learn from these input along with the label. My machine learning algorithm will try to learn the patterns available in the input. So after some time during the testing phase, I am giving some images from the same input set, and I'm giving some other extra images to my machine. So now, based on the patterns, whatever learned during the training phase, now my machine can able to differentiate which is the fruit apple and which is not the fruit apple. So these are the some of the supervised learning algorithms used: linear regression, logistic regression, k-nearest neighbor algorithm, decision tree, random forest, Navier-Bayes support vector machine. So I'm not going to detail into this. And each and every algorithm having its own advantage and disadvantage. So depends upon the problem, whatever you are going to work, and depends upon the characteristics of data you are having, you select a particular machine learning algorithm and you can work on it. And these are the some of the applications of supervised learning algorithm. The first application is the virtual assistant. You all know about Siri, Amazon, Cortana. So all will be working based on the supervised learning. And then weather prediction and forecasting, also one of the example of supervised learning. So you have all seen the screen in your mobile screen. And next is biometric technology. So biometric technology, mainly we have iris recognition and also palm print recognition. Mainly it is used for security purpose. And supervised learning algorithm also used in healthcare. Mainly it is used for disease identification, drug discovery, medical imaging. So maybe someone will be working in medical imaging. So if an image is given to a machine, the machine can able to tell whether the particular image having a tumor or not. If there is a tumor, it has to tell whether it is a benign type or malignant type. So like that also you can do with supervised learning and disease predictions and all. And then in banking sector also, we are using supervised learning algorithm. to approve loan for a person. So that also decided by the supervised learning algorithm, whether to approve a loan for a person or not, or you want to identify the credit card fraud. So that also you can do with supervised learning algorithms. And next is unsupervised learning algorithm. So here some set of images are given to my machine learning algorithm. So there is no labels given to this machine. So the machine itself tried to identify some common patterns available in the input image. And finally, the machine can able to group it into different varieties. Okay, so now it have oranges, apples, and cherries. So these are some of the unsupervised learning algorithms: k-means, fuzzy c-means, hierarchical clustering, expectation maximization, dbScan, and a priori. And these are the, some of the applications of unsupervised learning algorithm. The main application is the recommendation engine. So you all familiar with that? You have do Amazon purchasing. So whenever you do purchasing and logged out, when you go for the next time, immediately in your first page itself, you will get a message, recommendations of products for you. And same thing in YouTube also, you are watching some regular series. So if a new series is coming in that movie, so automatically you will get a recommendation. And if you did go with medical imaging, so if you want to identify the location of the tumors, you can go for unsupervised learning. And in social media also, we are using the unsupervised learning to cluster the people who have the same interest. So whenever you post a photo, you will get a tagging of friends. And also if you have LinkedIn and you have ResearchGate, so whoever researchers having the same interest, same as you, so immediately it will give a recommendations. And Google search engine also one of the application of the unsupervised learning. And object deduction in a scene. So you want to identify which is car, which is the floor, and which is tree, which is a sky, road. So that to differentiate also you can use with unsupervised learning algorithms. And next is the reinforcement algorithm. So in reinforcement algorithm, the agent will do an action in the environment. So if it is good, it will get a reward. If it do some unwanted thing, it will get a penalty. So based on its action and the reflections, so the agent can able to redefine its action. So if you see here in this diagram, so the agent has either two ways, either go to the fire or it go to a bucket. So the agent can, without knowing that it is going to the fire, and there it get a penalty. So always next time it will know, it don't have to go to the fire, it has to go to near to the bucket. So reinforcement learning algorithms, so Q-learning, state action reward, state action algorithm, deep Q network, deep deterministic policy, Grady method. So these are the some of the reinforcement learning algorithms used. And the applications of reinforcement learning algorithm, mainly the robotics used in industries and self-driving car. And generally all gaming environment using these reinforcement learning. So I think you all played Mario game. So whenever you get some performance, you will get a penalty. Whenever you do some wrong, you will, sorry, whenever you do something good, you will get a reward. Whenever you do something wrong, you will get a penalty. And next we'll see the categories of machine learning algorithm. So generally all the machine learning problems are fall into four main category. First one is regression. Second one is classification, third one is clustering, and the last one is association. So regression and classifications are grouped together as a supervised learning algorithm. Clustering and association are grouped under the category of unsupervised learning algorithm. So now I have a question. So what is the difference between regression and classification? Because both are supervised learning algorithm. So how will you differentiate the problem can be a regression or it can be a classification? Any idea? So how will you differentiate your problem can be a regression or a classification?
Discrete versus continuous.
Discrete versus continuous. Okay. So actually I will give one, again, I will give one case study. Okay, so supervised learning algorithms are generally grouped into regression and classification. Okay, so now I have a case study. So I have a temperature data, weather forecasting data, so which may be collected for last 1 year. So this data having some information such as dew point, humidity, sea level pressure, wind, precipitation, temperature, and climate. Okay, So now I am going to ask a question. So what is the temperature going to be tomorrow? So immediately the answer will be a numerical value, okay, 84 degree or 45 degree Celsius. So whatever thing. So you will get some numerical value. So if your output variable is a numerical variable, then your problem is a regression problem. And then the next question I will ask, will it be cold or hot tomorrow? So the answer can be either cold or it can be hot. So your output can be a categorical variable either with cold or hot. So that will be called as a classification problem. So now I have given a problem statement here to study the house sales data set and build a machine learning model that predicts the house pricing index. You feel what are the things will be considered as a predictor variable here? So what are the things we will consider as a predictor variable here? So you know what is meant by predictor variable. Predictor variable means input variables. Target variable means your output variable. So what are the things we'll use as a predictor variable here? Or which machine learning model we will use, regression or classification? Which model we will use, regression or classification? Okay, so now we'll use regression model. So these are the some of the predictors I have considered, that is date, square feet of living, number of rooms, number of floors available, and based on that your model can able to predict what will be the house pricing. So now I will give the next problem statement. So you want to study a bank credit data set and you have to make a decision about whether to approve the loan of an applicant based on its profile. So now you consider which type of problem it is, classification or regression. So this type of problem, classification or regression. So this problem is a classification model. So we are giving the input features as age, income, savings account, credit duration. So based on that, your classifier model will tell whether to approve the loan or not approve the loan or reject the loan. And next is the unsupervised learning problem. So that will be categorized into mainly clustering and association. So to understand about clustering, I'll give an example. Okay, so you have a kid. So you are providing a GEMS package to the kid. So what the kid immediately will do sometimes. So what it will do, it will try to group that GEMS into based on colors. Okay. So the children try to discover some patterns available in the input data. So like that, the machine also try to discover some similar patterns to group these data. Okay. So whenever you group these data, the data points inside the group is very similar. The data points between the group is not very similar. Okay. So the next one is association. So associations are mainly used in recommendation system. So whenever you bought something in Amazon, whenever I bought a new mobile, so immediately I will get a recommendation. The person whoever bought this mobile, they also purchased this case cover, this headset. So it will give a recommendation to you. So it will discover some rules based on the data. So that is called as association. So now I have given a problem statement. So you want to cluster a set of fruits as either apple or orange based on their characteristics. So immediately the word itself, it is still cluster. So I will give the input as color, width, shape, circumference, mass. So my clustering model can able to group it either apple or orange. And these are the popular machine learning tools, that is scikit, PyTorch, TensorFlow. So these all comes under Python library. And apart from that, we have Vega, R programming, RapidMiner, MATLAB, Google Colab. So you can do machine learning through all any one of this platform. And these are the some of the main Python libraries which will support for machine learning. So libraries are nothing but collection of functions which will able to do some specific task. So by using these Python libraries, you need not to write the code from the scratch. So the developer need not to spend more amount of time to writing the code. Just they can import the toolbox and use these. Okay, so these are the some of the tools which is used for machine learning and deep learning. So we have NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, SciPy, scikit-learn, TensorFlow, and Keras. So scikit-learn is a main library which contains all your machine learning algorithms. So TensorFlow and Keras are mainly used for deep learning purpose. And now I will show one case study. So we want to identify the species of the particular flower. So you have to classify the type of the flower based on the K nearest neighbor algorithm. So the main use of K nearest neighbor algorithm is classification. So you can use K nearest neighbor for regression also, but the main usage of K nearest neighbor is the classification. So you want to classify a flower. So the inputs of that flower is sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. And what you want to predict from the input? You want to predict what is the type of the flower, whether it is setosa, versicolor, or virginica. So here these class labels are given in string. As I already told that the machine will not understand string values. So you need to convert these as a numerical values. So here setosa is identified with label 0, versicolor is labeled with 1, and virginica will be labeled with 2. So like that, now your data set is now ready. So we have sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and the target label. And these are the steps you have to follow to implement any machine learning algorithm. First one is you have to import necessary modules. So here I have used the sklearn library because I told that machine learning algorithms are available in the scikit library. So I have to import now a classifier called as k-nearest neighbor classifier. Then all the input data I have to divide into train and testing. So we have a function called as train test split, and you want to load the data. So this load iris is a data set which is already predefined in the Python environment. So we have to import it. So the next step is loading the data set. So we have to load the data set. Once we have loaded the data set, the next step is pre-processing. Okay. So as you already know that maybe your data having some inconsistent value, missing value, null values, or your data may have some string values. So all these things you have to pre-process in this stage, or you need to do normalization. Everything you have to do here. And the next step is you have to differentiate what are your predictor variables, what is your target variable. So here the first four fields are your predictor variable, and the last column is your target variable. So after doing that, you have to split your data into training set and testing set. So here I have specified the test size is 0.25, so automatically training may have 75%. And next we have to define what is the classifier you are going to use. So here I have given K nearest neighbor classifier. The number of neighbors to be considered is 7. So once you define the machine learning algorithm by using the fit function, you have to train your model by passing your training data along with the label because it is a supervised learning algorithm. And next is predicting. So once your model is trained with the training data set, next you have to pass your testing data set to predict the performance of your model. So I will tell how the working principle of KNN nearest neighbor algorithm. So here you have a question mark with yellow color, which is an unknown data point. You want to classify this data point either to class A or class B. Okay. So we have to define a classifier, and you have to tell how many number of neighbors you have to consider. So here I have considered the number of neighbors 3. So I have to find the closest neighbor to this unknown data point. So here I have considered 1 red color and 2 green color, which is the closest neighbor based on Euclidean distance. So once it is identified, now you have to apply a voting system. So now by seeing these 3 neighbors, you can able to understand 2 are majority, that is a green color. So automatically this unknown data point will be now grouped to the class called as class B. And the next topic is deep learning. So deep learning is mainly inspired by human brain. And here we build the deep learning model in order to mimic the human brain. Okay. The idea behind deep learning is the artificial neural network. So you all know that our brain can identify the patterns and classify the type of information which is stored in our brain. So later, whenever we are giving a new input to your brain, the brain try to compare these information which is already known inside, and based on that it will try to make any predictions. Okay, so artificial neural networks with representation learning is generally known as deep learning. And this slide give you a differentiation between machine learning and the deep learning. So generally deep learning is nothing but the next evolution of machine learning, and these are the some of the different differences between machine learning and deep learning. So first one is data dependency. So if you see this graph, so whenever the amount of data is less, the deep learning performance also less. So when the amount of data are going to increase, the deep learning performance also going to increase. But in machine learning, even though with small amount of data, the machine learning algorithm will work well. But in deep learning, it will based on large amount of data. So by giving large amount of data only, your machine, your deep learning model can able to understand the information from your data. And next is hardware dependency. So machine learning will generally work in low-end machines, but deep learning will require high-end machines. The reason is deep learning is mainly based on neural networks. So we need to do more amount of multiplication job. That's why we are considering GPU instead of CPU for concurrent processing. And next is feature engineering. So in machine learning, every features you have to hard code the handcrafted features only given to the machine learning model. But in deep learning, the model can automatically discover the features and patterns from the input data. In case of problem solving approach, in machine learning, your problem is divided into several subsets and each will be get a solution. And finally, that answers will be combined to get a final solution. But in deep learning, we have to solve the problem in an end-to-end manner. As compared with the execution time, machine learning generally takes less time as compared with deep learning. But deep learning takes more time to execute because it has so many parameters to be tuned in the model. So if you want to develop some model from the scratch, it means take some 1 week or 2 weeks to train the model only. Okay, so you can either use some pre-trained model or transfer learning concept in order to reduce this timing. And next is the interpretability. So machine learning, whatever reasoning behind it, it can be easily interpretable. But in deep learning, it is not that much easy to interpret what is the reasoning behind the particular model. And this diagram gives you a difference between traditional machine learning and deep learning. In machine learning, all the features will be handcrafted and it should be given manually to the machine learning model. So the machine learning model's performance is mainly depend on the features, whatever you extracted. But in deep learning, you give a raw input data, the deep learning itself try to understand the patterns from the input. So it doesn't need any domain expertise. And it also try to learn the features from low level to the high level. So if you see here the face recognition system. So in the first layer, we have some edges, lines and all from the face, that is local information. And next you go, some high level features are extracted. And the next level you go, the other high level features are extracted. So it is called as end-to-end learning. And these are some of the popular deep learning models. So first one is the convolutional neural network. Mainly it is used for image classification. And next is the recurrent neural network, which is mainly used for time series data and natural language processing, speech translations and all. And next is the autoencoder, which is used for dimensionality reduction and image denoising. And then deep belief network, which is used for image and video recognition. And generative adversarial network, which is used to generate some pictures. Okay, so you want to generate some realistic pictures, you can use this GANs network. So not only these models are there, so still we have several models which will depends upon different application. We have the different deep learning models. And now layers in the deep learning. So basically your neural network having three different layers. That is your input layer, output layer, and along with the hidden layer. So a simple neural network may have two or three hidden layers, but if the hidden layers go very deep, then it becomes deep learning network, okay? So the hidden layers can be either convolutional layer, activation layer, batch normalization layer, dropout layer, pooling layer, flattened layer, and dense layer. So now I will show you one case study. So you want to classify a particular digit based on the convolutional neural network. Again, it is an image classification problem. So here I'm going to consider the first layer is the convolution layer. So before that, you have to know what is mean by convolution. So convolution is nothing but element by element multiplication followed by sum. So generally your image is convolved with a filter. So this is your image and this is a filter. Then it is placed above your image and it will go through each and every pixel in your image, you will get the convolved feature. So the convolved feature is nothing but features extracted from your image. So it depends upon the number of filters, you will get different types of features which are extracted from your image. Okay. So if you see here, the image size is 5x5, but your convolved feature is only 3x3. The reason is, whenever you place this filter above your image, so for the pixels which are available in the first row, last row, first column, last column, it doesn't have anything in the borders. So that's why we cannot calculate the convolution value for all the border pixels. So we can able to do the convolution values only for the inner pixels. That's why we are getting the 3x3 matrix. And next is the pooling layer. So pooling layer is mainly used to reduce the spatial size of an image. Okay. So here I have given a 4x4 image. The pooling layer can be either max pooling or average pooling. If it is a max pooling, means every 2x2, the maximum value will be taken and put as an output. If it's an average, you take an average and put it here. So automatically the size is reduced to half. And next is the dropout layer. And in neural network, so whenever you pass the information from one layer to another layer, most of the nodes in that layer will have a duplicate values. So you need not to send the duplicated values to the next layer. So we apply the dropout. Okay, dropout will remove that redundancy in order to avoid overfitting of your network. And next is flatten. So flatten will convert your two-dimensional image into one-dimensional. Suppose you are giving 4x4, automatically it will be converted to 1x16. And next is the last one is fully connected layer. In fully connected, all your nodes, getting the connection from the nodes which is available in the previous layer. So here every node is connected to every other node in your fully connected layer. And now again, if you want to implement the deep learning model, the first step is you have to import necessary libraries. So you have to import NumPy. So here we are using with the Keras platform. So I have to use the Keras. So I have to load the MNIST dataset, which is again available in the predefined dataset in the Python. And the model I want to develop is a sequential model, and which contain convolutional layer, max pooling layer, dense layer, dropout layer, and flattened layer. So once your libraries are imported, the next step is loading of data. So you have to load the data. So whenever you load the data itself, you have training image, training label, testing image, and testing label. So again, if you want to do any pre-processing, so you can do the pre-processing. So once the pre-processing is done, so next step is you want to create the model. So before doing that, so I will show this. So this is my training image. So I want to recognize the digits available in the image. So generally you have 0 to 9 digits, so 10 classes. So that are labeled from class 0, class 1, because digit 0, digit 1, up to digit 9. So by using these training data, your model is trained. So once your model is trained, the next thing is you have to test it. So now I am giving an unknown data with the digit 5. So now my model can able to recognize what is the class label. So here it is identifying the class label is 5. So this is a simple model I have used. So first we are using the convolutional layer with having number of filters 32 with the kernel size of 5x5. And then it is going max pooling layer. So the image size is reduced to half. Then it will go to dropout layer, that 20% redundant information is dropped. Then it is going flatten. So two-dimensional information are converted to one-dimensional thing. And then it finally go to fully connected layer, which having only 10 labels, because 10 nodes, because you have only 10 outputs. So your output layer contains only 10 nodes. So in order to design it, we have a sequential function, because it is a sequential model. You are stacking up one layer after other. And then the first layer is a convolutional layer, which contain the number of filters 32, each filter with a size of 5x5. The filter values are randomly assigned later by studying the pattern from the image. So these features are updated. And then input shape of your image is 28x28. But after convolution, you are getting 24x24. The reason is the first two rows, last two rows, first two columns, first, last two columns, we cannot apply convolution operation because the size of your filter is 5x5. The activation function used here is ReLU. Apart from that, you know about sigmoid, tanH, leaky ReLU and all. And the next layer is the max pooling layer, which is giving a size of 2x2. So half the size of your image is reduced. And next is dropout, 20% of redundant information is dropped out. And next is flatten, all your two-dimensional input is now converted as a one-dimensional input. So we have several nodes. Now we are going to restrict that nodes into only 128 nodes in the dense layer. And after that, again, that 128 is restricted to the output layer to the number of classes. Here, the number of classes we are using is only 10. So 128 is fully connected to the number of output layers, output nodes of 10. So in the previous layer, you have 128 nodes. In the last layer, that is the output layer, contains only 10 nodes. So all the nodes from your previous layer is fully connected with your output layer. And your output layer, you have an activation function called as softmax. So that will do the classification, which is based on probability-based classification. So every node get a probability. So the node which having a highest probability will be taken as a class label. And the next is you have to compile the model. So to compile the model, you have to set your model has to be validated based on loss and what type of optimizer you have to use. And which metric base you want to evaluate the performance of your model. So generally classification will be evaluated based on accuracy. And next is the fitting of the model. To fit the model, you pass your training data, training label, how many number of epochs it's need, that is your iteration. And batch size means maybe you have some 1 lakh data. You cannot give all the 1 lakh data at a sudden. So you have to give the input like batch-wise batch, okay? Then the last one is evaluation of the model. To evaluate, you have to pass your testing data and the testing label. How much accurately your system can able to predict your output. And finally, the prediction. And as a summary, the deep learning process, the first step, you will understand the problem and you have to decide whether the deep learning is good to fit for your problem. So once you identify all those things, the next step, you identify the relevant data set and prepare the data for the analysis. In the third step, choose a deep learning, whichever preferable for your input data and for your problem domain. And the fourth step, you have to train the algorithm. So you can either use compile and fit method to compile, train your model. And the last step is you have to predict your model using the evaluate function and predict function. Thank you.
If anyone has any feedback, they can post in the chat box. Ma'am, can you see the questions?
Okay. So what is the other Keras model? You can use this sequential model. So you can use with convolution. So here I have used one example. It's a sequential model. So apart from that, you can directly create convolutional model itself also. You can directly create from that. So which framework is better for video data? So you can either go for deep belief network or you can go for RNN, because RNN is using with time series data, because video is a time series data. So you can go with that.
Yeah, ma'am, another one question is there in the chat box.
Typical application of autoencoder. So generally autoencoder is used for dimensionality reduction. So if you go for classification, so you want to extract features. So that also you can do with autoencoder. After extracting the features from the autoencoder, that can be given to the classification because it is used for dimensionality reduction. So another one uses, you can go for image compression also, you can try with autoencoder. So data mining and data mining, we have separate algorithms for data mining, which is mainly used for data analytics. So you will analyze how you are, I have told about exploratory data analysis. But machine learning, you use with learning algorithms, supervised learning algorithm. Depends upon your problem domain, you choose any one of the machine learning algorithm and work with it. Only two models. It's not two models. So we have several models. So you have Keras documentation. So by seeing the Keras documentation, you can able to understand what are the other models available. Is there a number of hidden layers related to the training time? Yes. If you increase the number of hidden layers, really it will take large time to computation, large time of computation. So if the number of hidden layer increase, the final that depends upon your data set. Okay, so I told about the characteristics of data influences your model. So if your data is like that, if you increase the number of layers, it will give a good result. But we can tell that if you increase the number of layer, it will give a good performance. Maybe it may into overfitting. So generally we use with MATLAB or we can try with Python. So laptop, you can prefer the GPU based laptops, but we cannot expect as such whatever in the research level, but at least we can try with small minimum effort in our laptops. So I am working with generally in image processing. So I don't know specifically on intrusion detections and all. Networking concept, maybe in MATLAB itself we have several simulation tools and all. Python also having intrusion detection and all, so you can use with it. Is it necessary to Python programming? No, it's not necessary. Even though you have in Windows, by using Anaconda Spider platform, you can use it. So you need the necessary library files to be imported in your Python environment, so you can use it. No need of Linux and all. How can you split and testing the training data? So in Python itself, we have a function called as test train split. So by using that function, you will give an input. You have to specify in what ratio you want to divide your testing and training data set. So based on that, it will divide your data into testing and training. Is fully connected layer is a deep layer network. Fully connected layer is only the layer which is available end of your network. Okay, so after that fully connected layer only you have your output layer. From where we will get data? Medical image. Okay, so generally if you have the data like text data, that is numerical data, you can go for UCIF database, UCI repository. Or if you want to use with medical images specifically to your problem domain, you have to search it, because every data set doesn't having all type of medical images. So we have mammogramming specifically, you have Maya's database, BDSM database. And then if you need some lung cancer means that type of database. So you have some brain means brain data set is there. So you can just go with Gaggle data set, that is Gaggle website, that also having several data sets. So which data set is useful for video surveillance? So that also again, you have to take some real time data or some, there are some, that is, what it is, we have some predefined data, standard data. Okay, so first you will test all your testing with the standard data set. Okay, so once you get a good result with your standard data set, then you will go with real-time data set. Can you suggest some tools? So again, I told machine learning, I told with remote sensing images, the machine learning algorithms are same. Okay, so you have to define what type of problem you are going to do, whether you are going to do with regression, classification or clustering, that you have to decide. Okay, then each and every input image having some characteristics. So based on the characteristics, you have to decide which feature extraction algorithm is suitable for your problem. So by studying the literatures, you have to identify what are the features you can use to for the machine learning. Then you extract that features and try to use the different machine learning algorithm, because it all will be trial and error method. So you have to read your literature survey. So based on that, you will collect which are the features are necessary, and then you test with the different machine learning algorithms. And the mammogram images are generally available in MIAS dataset, MIAS, MIAS, and it also available in DDSM, Digital Mammography Dataset. So that also written. How dropout is performed? So as I already told that dropout generally made the system overfitting. Okay, so most of some repeated data will be moved from one node to another node. So in order to avoid overfitting, we have to drop the data. So in Python itself, we have function called as dropout. So you have to give how much percentage of data you want to drop out. So if you give that dropout percentage, so that much amount of values will be dropped out to the next layer. Root problem reminds us that features identified by is not trustworthy. What solution we can? So you are telling Hussey dog, root problem is an optimization problem. So I don't think so. Hussey does root problem. So it's like an optimization problem. Yes, the features are not trustworthy. So if it is an optimization problem, so you again you have to go through the standard data set, and then you have to go with trial and error method. You will start with PSO, then you can go with the advanced optimization technique algorithm, because I have already told that every algorithm not work for every data set, because each data set has its own feature characteristics. So you have to come only with the literature survey based results, or you can do with the trial and error method. So I don't know about Echo Cardiologic public data set. So I'm not sure about that data set. Or DBNS good for speech data. So generally we will use RNN for speech translation because it is the time series data. So you want to recognize something in your image or video, you can go with DBN, Deep Belief Network. Any other questions?
Yeah, any other queries? Participants, any other queries?
So if you have...
Okay, I think no more queries.
I will give my... So if you have any other related specific queries, so you can mail to me.
Okay, ma'am. Can you type it on the... Yeah, fine. Thank you. Chat. Okay. Okay, so I think one more question is there from Srihala Kishore.
Are you using speech to test? So as I already told, I am working with medical image processing. I have used mammogram images and also have used lung images. So as for now, I didn't use speech to text processing.
There is another one question about that. It's about your email
ID. Maya's database.
By Srihala.
Both are freely available. That's why I asked, you send a mail to me, so I will give a link.
So I guess there are no more queries. We can wind up the session.
Oh, data augmentation will increase the data set. Sure. So generally, if you have small amount of data, not enough data, okay, so you can apply data augmentation technique to generate images. But I think for medical images and all, it's how it will be, but they are using data augmentation technique. But it will work for, good work for natural images, that's sure. But medical images, so you do with different orientation testings and all, then you will finalize. So this question, already I told that I don't know about echocardiographic data set because I'm not sure with that. I didn't work with this data set.
Yeah, that we will arrange for the another one session, I think. I think we can now wind up the session.
Okay, sir.
So, Anjali, can you please continue?
Yes, sir. So, since all queries have been clarified, we move on to the vote of thanks. I request Mr. Thomas George, sir, to deliver the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Okay, am I audible?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
So, the name of Jyoti Engineering College and CSE Department. I express our deep gratitude to our speaker, Dr. J. Anita. Thank you very much, ma'am, for sparing your time to share your thoughts on machine learning and deep learning. So, with a lot of examples,
thank you, sir.
With a lot of examples, case studies, code, etc. So, it was very informative and interesting.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
I also thank our management, principal, and HOD CSE for their constant support and encouragement for conducting this type of webinars. So let me also thank all the participants for all who are actively participating in this webinar. So thank you so much. And I also thank our entire team CSE for their efforts, especially to Fritzlin sir, Ashwati miss and Supna miss. So without their support, this webinar would not have happened. So once again, thank you all.